When you look at the control room in a large commercial studio, you may see multiple sets of studio monitors. The monitors closest to the listening position are called near-field or sometimes mid-field monitors, and some studios also have larger speakers that are placed much further away. These are called far-field monitors. In this video, let's look and listen to the differences and determine if you should be using near-field monitors, mid-field monitors, far-field monitors, or all three in your studio. I'll be using Sonarworks SoundID reference for some of the demonstrations, specifically the virtual monitoring add-on. You can download a free trial to this software with the link below the video, and you'll also find a discount code for 10% off if you decide it's a good fit for you. Thanks to Sonarworks for sponsoring this video and supporting audio education. Let's start with some audio examples. You'll want to wear headphones for this. Learning to communicate what you're hearing is a very important skill for music producers and engineers. So leave a comment below describing how each one sounds different to you, and then compare your answers to what others thought. Before discussing the sound differences and how they can help you to create better mixes, let's start with the obvious. Far-field monitors are designed to be placed far away from the listener, maybe 10 feet or more. Near-field monitors are designed to be placed near the listener, between about 3 and 5 feet, and mid-field monitors are designed to be placed somewhere in between. But these ranges will vary depending on who you ask. Due to the fact that far-field monitors are intended to be placed further from the listening position, they're typically capable of greater max SPL, or sound pressure level. Take, for example, the Atom S5H monitors with a max SPL of more than 131 dB per pair at 1 meter. These could be a very powerful pair of far-field or mid-field monitors, because by the time the sound travels over a long 10-foot distance, it could still be as loud as 121 dB SPL, allowing you to run the speakers at well below the maximum level while still achieving an appropriate listening level at the listening position. Now compare that to the Atom A7Vs with a max SPL of 105 dB at 1 meter. If you placed these monitors 10 feet away from the listener, they would struggle to reach 95 dB SPL. 95 dB SPL is very loud, but remember, this is the maximum with sine bursts, not continuous music. The Atom A7Vs are therefore designed to be used in the near or midfield. At those distances, these monitors will have no problem providing adequate SPL. The same for the T5Vs, with a max SPL per pair of more than 106 dB at 1 meter. Ideally, we would have our monitors calibrated so that the near field and far field monitors output the same level at a given level on the monitor master knob. Naturally, the virtual monitoring within SoundID reference matches the level of each monitor type, as you heard in the demonstration. The reason this is important is that we usually want to A/B things at the same level so we can listen to other differences that might be more subtle than the overall level difference. But when you need some extra SPL to listen to the mix louder, whether for mixing purposes or just to show off to clients in the room, more powerful speakers will come in handy. Beyond the additional SPL, you can also expect more extension down into the low frequencies when using a pair of far-field monitors, or when using bigger monitors in general. Larger woofers, or coupling of multiple woofers, can allow for lower frequency signals to be accurately reproduced. This means a smaller near-field monitor won't provide the same insight into the low end of a mix as you can gain from larger far-field monitors. But does that align with what you heard in the listening examples? I wouldn't say the difference between these three pairs of virtual monitors could be summed up by merely saying the far field monitors have more bass. There seem to be differences throughout the spectrum. Keep in mind that studios won't typically use the same monitors in three sizes, but rather three different monitors entirely. Therefore, even after running SoundID reference with a measurement microphone and applying corrective EQ, the speakers will still have some unique characteristics throughout the mid-range and the highs. This gets to one very important reason why studios have multiple sets of monitors, including near-field, mid-field, and far-field, to test the mix for a variety of playback scenarios. The people listening to your music won't be listening on your system in your room. They'll be listening on their own playback system, which could be anything. That's one reason the SoundID Reference Virtual Monitoring add-on offers the ability to simulate the way something will sound on different monitors, as well as various laptops, phones, TVs, and cars. Listen closely to how the low, mid, and high range frequencies are more or less prominent depending on the playback system. Using multiple sets of monitors that vary widely is a way to achieve a similar outcome, a mix that is resilient and that translates well to other systems. One pair of studio monitors can sound very different depending on the acoustic characteristics of a room. I've recently added acoustic treatment to my room, which has made a big difference to the frequency response and the reverb time. Now that I have acoustic treatment in my room, the critical distance has moved back further from the speakers. The critical distance describes the point in the room where the direct sound and the indirect sound are equal in level. No acoustic treatment, and the critical distance is pretty short because there's much more indirect sound in relation to the direct sound. In any case, near-field monitors will provide the listener with the greatest ratio of direct to indirect sound. Not because they're near-field monitors, but because they're monitors being used in the near-field. This is another big difference that I hear when comparing the near, mid, and far-field monitor emulations. Listen again, but this time focus in on the reverb and clarity differences.
How easy it would be to fall for you. But that, of course, is something I won't do. 'Cause we've agreed between you and me, we're nothing more. How silly it would be to put this friendship to an end. How crazy that would be, yet here I am falling in.
The far field monitors seem to have the longest reverb tail, while the near field monitors have a relatively dry sound. This difference could inform the amount of reverb you add in a mix, and it also impacts the overall sound quality, as some of the additional reverb can cause additional masking at various frequencies throughout the spectrum. For me, this is similar to the difference between studio monitors and headphones, which are essentially extremely near-field monitors. Headphones will give you the most detailed and dry sound, while far-field monitors can sometimes have a smearing impact on a mix by comparison. Again, this isn't necessarily a bad thing. It just gives you another perspective, which is good. Considering that my room is only 14 feet long, I only use near-field monitors. It would be impractical to sit 4 feet from the back wall with a gigantic pair of studio monitors taking up a quarter of the space in my room. Would I love to have a larger control room like you can find in commercial studios? Yes, of course. But for now, I'm making the most of what I've got. That means I've got high quality studio monitors, acoustic treatment on the walls and ceilings, and corrective EQ. When I want to test on other systems, I can either print the track and play it on other systems, or test it right here in the DAW on a variety of virtual playback systems using SoundID Reference with the virtual monitoring add-on. These steps help to ensure that the sound of your mix is acceptable no matter how someone is listening. You'll find free trial links in the show notes below the video, and for a limited time, you'll also find that 10% off discount code. In the next video that's on your screen now, you'll learn the most important places to put acoustic treatment in your room. I'll see you there.